and myself, for President Bush and Barbara, they're on the hearts of every American. This morning, we understand they had a good night last night, but we encourage every American to remember President Bush and his wonderful wife, Barbara, in their prayers. 72 days ago, we elected Donald Trump to be the 45th President of the United States of America. 71 days ago, Donald Trump set an ambitious schedule prior to this inauguration, and he asked me to chair the transition effort. And I was grateful and honored to be given the opportunity to do just that. When we took over, I was impressed, frankly, with the work that Governor Christie and the transition team had done prior to the election. More than 170 interviews had already been done prior to Election Day. And I'm pleased to report that as of this morning's announcement for our Secretary of Agriculture, all 21 cabinet nominees have been named. 27 total individuals have been named that require the consent of the Senate. And we have 536 beachhead team members that will be reporting for duty at agencies following the inauguration bright and early on Monday morning. There are many people to thank in this regard, and I'm really here just to do that. There is a memorandum that will be in your possession by the end of this briefing that I'll be conveying to the President-elect today to give him a full report on the transition efforts and the progress that we've made, but allow me to give you a couple of top lines. In addition to the hundreds of interviews and meetings that the President-elect has conducted in the course of this transition, I'm pleased to report that the presidential appointments team has conducted more than 170 interviews prior to the election. More than 200 people since the election have sat down with what we call our tiger teams for full vetting and full review. I'm happy to say the interest of the American people in this administration has been overwhelming. More than 86,000 resumes have been submitted to the transition and over 4,000 candidate referrals. And on the eve of the inauguration, as I mentioned, our beachhead teams are ready to land and go to work in these various agencies of the incoming administration. On legislative affairs, we organized more than 90 volunteers to create and execute a confirmation strategy to support the 27 publicly announced Senate confirmed nominees. Designees attended so far more than 370 visits with senators, and we'll continue to work very, very closely to support their efforts as they move toward confirmation. There's been work on agency action, as I mentioned. Policy implementation, though, has also been very brisk in the course of this transition. Specifically, we focused at the President-elect's direction on a day one, a day 100, and a day 200 action plan for keeping our word to the American people and putting the President-elect's promises into practice. 14 policy implementation teams attracted over 110 active team participants. Additionally, 90 experts have been serving in an advisory capacity as we formulated executive action and legislative policy to pursue the goals of this administration. In addition to that, we've been listening. We established through the course of the transition the Office of Nationwide Engagement, ONE for short, and they've been busy. 28 listening sessions conducted December 1 through January 13, and 22 business days met with and heard top policy issues and concerns from more than 1,200 organizations, associations, and various interests and entities. There's an awful lot of people to thank, and there's more details that you'll see in the memorandum that I'll be conveying to the President-elect today, but let me begin by expressing my appreciation, first and foremost, to President Barack Obama and Vice President Joe Biden. The cooperation that the outgoing administration has extended in this transition effort would make every American proud. And I know the President-elect has expressed his appreciation, not just for the hospitality, but for the collaboration of this administration in supporting our team's transition efforts. And I would reiterate that today. Also very grateful to the GSA Administrator, Denise Turner-Roth, and her outstanding team here at GSA for the work that they've done to support our efforts. Also grateful for the Vice Chairs and the Executive Committee of the transition effort who have put in very long hours. A number of them are with us today. Ben Carson is with us, Rudy Giuliani, Jeff Sessions, Marsha Blackburn, Tom Reed represent a part of the vice chair team, and we express our appreciation on behalf of the president-elect for the many, many hours that you put in helping us to assemble this day one team. We also express appreciation to the members of our executive committee who donated literally hundreds of hours in assisting us in preparing the recommendations to the president-elect over the course of this. Lastly, I've just two more things to mention. And number one is just to thank my team. You know, there's an old saying that when you see back in Indiana, when you see a box turtle on a fence post, one thing you know for sure is they had help getting there. And I can tell you that while it's been my privilege to chair this transition effort, the team that we've had around us and the extraordinary 7-day-a-week hours that they've put into this effort is greatly to their credit. I want to specifically thank the Executive Director, Rick Dearborn, who's done a masterful job. Extremely grateful for the energetic leadership of our incoming White House Chief of Staff, Ryan Primus, incoming General Counsel at the White House, Don McGahn, literally working almost around the clock in supporting the efforts of this transition effort. For our team here, Bill Hagerty on presidential appointments, Ron Nickel on agency action, Otto Machito and Andrew Bremberg on policy, Jamie Burke and Elizabeth Pinkerton on personnel, Eric Euland on legislative affairs, and a balance of a team that would make anyone proud. The progress that we have made in the course of this transition and the extraordinarily brisk pace with which it's been conducted is a tribute to the integrity and the work ethic of these men and women. And I know the president-elect is grateful for their efforts, and as chair, I am as well. Ken Nahagian is taking over as executive director to wind down the transition. The Office of White House Personnel will take over the official duties as we continue in the weeks and months ahead to fill out the balance of the administration. But this is the team that got us here to this day at the direction of the president-elect. Lastly, I'm especially pleased, and I know the president-elect is especially pleased, that we're wrapping up this transition on schedule and under budget. we will actually return some 20% of taxpayer funding back to the U.S. Treasury, and that is just exactly in keeping with the president-elect's expectations going forward. He is a businessman that knows how to sharpen his pencil, and I'm very pleased to report today that we were able to do that and restore those dollars to the Treasury. But let me say, I've been very very honored to serve as chair of the transition effort, but all that we've accomplished here, credit goes to a great team, our volunteers, literally hundreds and hundreds of volunteers who've put in hours and hours to support this effort, our executive committee, our vice chairs, our staff. But really, the credit, I can tell you, goes to our president-elect. Sometimes people stop me on the street and they say, how are you holding up? I can't imagine how busy you are. And I just tell them, well, you just have to understand that the energy and the enthusiasm of Donald Trump is contagious. And it's been his energy and his expectation that's driven this transition effort. I'm proud to say to be at a place where we've named our entire cabinet before we reach that historic day tomorrow. Our job really was to make sure the president-elect had the opportunity to make decisions, to assemble the team around him that will make America great again, and I'm humbled to have been a small part of that. Our job is to be ready on day one. The American people can be confident that we will be. Let me say to all of you, we look forward to seeing you tomorrow. It'll be a very humbling and moving day for the president-elect, his family, and for mine. But let me tell you, we are all ready to go to work. In fact, we can't wait to get to work for the American people to make America great again. So thank you very much, and we'll provide that information for you at the end of the briefing. Thanks.
Could I ask you, how many nominees do you expect to have confirmed by the end of this morning?
You're up. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Vice President-elect. I think he speaks for all of us when we say that we are truly excited for tomorrow. There's a historic change coming, and it is infectious. The entire team is looking forward to this now that we are 24 hours out of this. So The president-elect continues to make edits and additions to his inaugural address. We'll have further updates for you on that, but I know it was asked yesterday. In the speech, it's going to be a very personal and sincere statement about his vision for the country. He will discuss what it means to be an American, the challenges that we face as members of the middle class that they face. He'll talk about infrastructure and education, our manufacturing base. I think it's going to be less of an agenda and more of a philosophical document, a vision of where he sees the country, the proper role of government, the role of citizens. So look forward to that tomorrow. With respect to the action on Capitol Hill that the Vice President-elect was mentioning, I think the nominees continue to go up to Capitol Hill and impress the American people and the United States Senator with the caliber and quality of people that the President-elect has chosen. Shelley Moore Capital of West Virginia said of Scott Pruitt, he's the best choice for the EPA. He'll help restore the EPA to its original lawful mission. As Leader McConnell mentioned of Wilbur Ross, that he's experienced to help turn the country around. John Thune said his business know-how will make him a great Commerce Secretary. Senator Marco Rubio of Florida said Governor Nikki Haley will stand up for American values at the UN. Arizona Governor Doug Ducey said that Dr. Tom Price is someone that Americans can finally work towards a patient-centered health care. Today, we've got more activity up on Capitol Hill. Energy Secretary nominee Rick Perry and Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin will both be up there on Capitol Hill testifying. I think no one understands the intersection of the American economy and the American industry, energy industry, than former Governor Rick Perry of Texas. He's well known to the Senate and to the American people. There's a great deal of reform coming to Washington, and nothing sends the message stronger that nominating a leader like Rick Perry to take the helm will do. Over his 30-year career in finance, Steven Mnuchin has established a reputation of being a solution-oriented leader, a dedicated team builder, and an excellent communicator. These qualities will serve him well as he works with Congress and the administration to hamper out a tax package that will spur economic growth, create jobs, and help hardworking Americans and allow businesses to compete on a global basis. I mentioned yesterday, but we will have further staff announcements today, both on the commission staff, the special assistants, deputy assistants, and assistants to the president. We'll also release some of the non-commissioned support staff as well. This morning, as the Vice President-elect noted, we have officially filled the cabinet with the announcement of Sonny Perdue as the next Secretary of Agriculture. A few more staff announcements, personnel notes that I want to get through. We will announce today that Dab Kern will remain at the White House as the Deputy Assistant to the President and Director of the White House Military Office. Dab has been serving in an acting role during the Obama administration. The President-elect intends to make that a permanent position for him. The President-elect understands how it's important to ensure the continuity of government. So in addition to the appointments that we've announced and will announce, the President-elect has asked over 50 individuals to stay in critical posts throughout the government. Included in this group are Robert Work, currently the Deputy Secretary of Defense, Chuck Rosenberg, the DEA Administrator, Nick Rasmussen, the Director of the National Counterterrorism Center, Tom Shannon, the Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs, Susan Coppedge in the Department of State, which is the Office to Monitor and Combat Trafficking in Persons, Brett McGurk, who is the Special Envoy for the Global Coalition to Counter ISIS, Cody Kinsley, the Assistant Secretary of Management, Department of Treasury, Adam Subin, who is the Acting Undersecretary for Terrorism and Financial Intelligence of the Department of Treasury, are just some of the individuals who will be staying aboard through the time being until a replacement can be named. Here's the rundown for events that are occurring today and tomorrow. Please keep in mind that all timing is approximate and continue to check the official schedule. Today at 12:30, the President-elect, Chief of Staff Reince Priebus, Mr. Tom Barrack, the Chairman of the Presidential Inaugural Committee, Sarah Armstrong, the CEO of the Presidential Inaugural Committee, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, White House Majority Leader Kevin McCarthy, and Cabinet designees and White House senior staff will attend a leadership luncheon at the Trump International Hotel. That's a pool event. At 3 p.m., there will be the President-elect, the Vice President-elect, and their families will attend a wreath-laying ceremony at Arlington National Cemetery. At 4 p.m., the President-elect, the Vice President-elect, and their families will attend the Make America Great Again rally and concert at the Lincoln Memorial. Tomorrow, big day for everyone. It's the next inauguration day. It's inauguration day. It'll begin with the president-elect, his family, the vice president-elect and his family, cabinet designees, family and friends attending an 8:30 church service at St. John's Church, located at 1525 H Street, right across from the White House. At 9:30, the president-elect and his family, the vice president-elect and his family, will attend a White House tea on the south portico of the White House. At 10:30, they will travel to the Capitol for the swearing-in. At 11 o'clock, the president-elect, the Trump family, vice president-elect and his family will attend the swearing-in on the west lawn of the U.S. Capitol. At 1 p.m., the president-elect, the vice president-elect, First Lady Melania Trump, Second Lady Karen Pence will attend a joint congressional inaugural committee luncheon at the U.S. Capitol. At 2:30 p.m., they will attend the military review located at the U.S. Capitol on the East Front. And at 3 o'clock, they will attend the inaugural parade in stands just outside of the White House. At 7 p.m., President Trump, Vice President Pence, First Lady Melania, Second Lady Karen Pence will attend the Liberty and Freedom Ball at the Washington Convention Center off Mount Vernon Ave. Following that, they'll attend the Military Ball, which is at the National Building Museum. On Saturday at approximately 10 a.m., the President, the Vice President and their families will attend the National Prayer Service at the Washington National Cathedral. Over the weekend, the incoming staff will be located here at the PTT to help support the transition. On the eve of the inauguration, one point that's important, we have over 536 beachhead team members. These are the individuals that are being placed into agencies and departments throughout the government. They have been identified to support those things. This is an unprecedented number of individuals that are going to be ready on day one, as far back as we can see. And I think that is important, as well as the individuals I mentioned early, to ensure continuity of government and to ensure that we're ready on day one to get things happening. We intend to have the first briefing at the White House on Monday in the James Brady briefing room. Time will be announced. As a logistical note, I would just say that during this weekend, we intend to, we've worked with the White House Correspondents Association to ensure that a pool camera is located here. Should there be a need for any briefing, this would be the location where it would take place in order to facilitate much easier logistics of getting in and out. I know some of you are interested in getting your passes. We're working with the current White House. They've been very helpful. Make sure you email our team. We'll help facilitate reporters who don't have hard passes to get in and out of the White House complex throughout the weekend and on Monday. Obviously, the greater leeway that we have in terms of timing is appreciated. With respect to the cabinet, before I turn it over, I think that there's no question, we've noted before, the high quality and caliber of the individuals that the president-elect has selected to lead his government. I think even the Senate leadership on the Democratic side admitted so much. They talked about going after just a few of them. And it's, I think what's a shame right now is to see some of those individuals who we would call consensus candidates, people who they didn't even find a problem with, people like Secretary Elaine Chao, Ben Carson, Nikki Haley, suddenly not be part of Senator Schumer's list that he will work with us to get done on day one. It's disappointing. These were people that are highly qualified, that were considered quote-unquote consensus candidates prior to a few weeks ago. And I think that it really speaks volumes that the Democratic leadership is not working with us to ensure a continuity of government. This was not the precedent that was set by Senate Republicans when they worked with the Obama administration in 2008 to ensure that the President Obama, despite political differences, got the cabinet of his choosing because they were qualified individuals. I expect the same standard for our individuals, and I think Senator Schumer should do the same, recognize that this is more about continuity of government and ensuring that these qualified individuals get voted on as soon as possible so that we can lead this country forward. With that, I'd be glad to take some of your questions. John Roberts.
Sean, yesterday you promised that you'd be able to shed a little more light on the first orders that the incoming president will sign
right
on Friday, and maybe give us some idea of what's coming up on Monday.
Yeah, I'm going to have to continue to update you on that. The president-elect is continuing to get briefed on some of the orders that he wants to do and the sequencing thereof. I think we've talked about that for a few months now. Obamacare, the fight against ISIS, he talked about immigration, key issues that have been important to him throughout the campaign that will continue to be important to him in this administration. He is committed to not just day one but day two, day three of enacting an agenda of real change. And I think that you're going to see that in the days and weeks to come. What he's trying to do is ensure a proper sequencing. Staff is continuing to meet with him about that. But again, I think you'll see some activity on both tomorrow, over the weekend, and then Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. So it's going to be a robust, not just day one, but I think day first week, first month, and probably first term.
Do you know how many of tomorrow's orders are simply processed?
I don't want to go there yet. I think the president-elect is still working through which ones he wants to deal with tomorrow versus Monday or Tuesday. We'll try to get a readout of those going forward, but it is a work in progress. There's a lot to be done.
Sean.
Yes.
Sean.
Yeah.
I'm Gavin with Univision. I would like to know if we are going to the White House press corps, are going to still work at the West Wing.
Yeah, I think that's been asked and answered. I mean, as you can tell by today, there is a tremendous interest, frankly, an unprecedented interest in covering this president. The demand and enthusiasm to understand the agenda that he has and that what he's going to be doing is you know, frankly, unprecedented. We have tried to be accommodating and looked at additional room space. As we've announced previously, we're going to continue, as I noted, we'll host the first meeting in the James Brady briefing room. It's going to be a little cramped, I imagine, but that's where we'll hold at least the first couple briefings for now. So I hope that answers. Cecilia.
Can you confirm that the president-elect has plans to go to the CIA in the near future, and is this, for lack of a better term, to make nice after everything that's happened?
Cecilia asked whether or not he had plans to go to the CIA. I'm sure that at some point shortly he will visit not just the CIA, but a lot of the departments. I mentioned yesterday during the briefing that the president continues to be humbled by the people who serve this nation and the work that they do so many times without the proper recognition for the sacrifices that they make in terms of time. So many of them could be making more in the private sector, but they continue to serve this government. And I think the enthusiasm to serve in government and be part of this administration has gotten greater by the day. There are so many people that have submitted a resume or said, I want to go back into public service or join the military because they've been inspired by the president-elect's message. And so I think not just the CIA, but several departments, he's going to visit and make sure that he tells them how much he appreciates their service to our country, their commitment to acting an agenda of change, and recognize how much they really do for this country. So it's not just going to be the CIA, but I think you're going to see a lot of activity throughout not just the first week, the first month, and the first year of making that a priority to thank so many of the people who serve our government. And again, not just federal servants, but so many people who volunteer their time in various ways to serve this nation, both paid and unpaid.
Does the president feel that there needs to be some fence mending, if you will, on behalf of the intelligence community?
No, I think he has been very clear. His statement that he put out the Friday that he got the briefing, he respects the work and diligence of the intelligence community. The men and women who so often serve in the intelligence community without recognition because of the very nature of the work they do is something that he has a true understanding of the sacrifice that they make. And so he has been very, very clear that while he may have differences sometimes with the leadership of the intelligence community, that the work of the individuals, the men and women who tirelessly support the analysis and readings of the intelligence community is something that he will continue to show his support for and his thanks.
Sean.
Kristen.
Thanks, Sean. Your list of cabinet picks is the first since 1988. It doesn't include any Hispanics. I know you got a question about this yesterday as well. What do you say to Hispanic groups who are concerned about that? And what do you say more broadly about the criticism that this undercuts President-elect Trump's argument that he is here to serve all Americans?
Well, he is here to serve all. I mean, thank you for the question. I think that when you look at the totality of his administration, the people that he's talked to, the people that he's met with, the people that he's appointing, you see a president who is committed to uniting this country, who's bringing the best and the brightest together. But look at the cabinet. Elaine Chao, Dr. Ben Carson, Governor Nikki Haley, the first Indian American. I think that the number one thing that I think Americans should focus on is he hiring the best and the brightest? Is he hiring people who are committed to enacting real change, respecting taxpayers, bringing about an agenda that will create jobs, lift up wages? And I think that what you're seeing and you're going to continue to see, not just through the cabinet, but through the entire thing, is a diversity in gender, a diversity of thinking, and a diversity of ideology. So it's not just about, you know, skin color or ethnic heritage, but you look at the totality of this cabinet, an Indian American, African American, you know, Asian American, it's about It's about a lot of things. And I think you can start to pick out one group and say, where is the percentage of that? But if you look at the totality of the people that he's meeting with, the people that he's bringing in for senior staff positions, cabinet, sub-cabinet, deputy, we're going to have 5,000 positions. And it's not so I think that you can pick out one subset. But if you look at the totality of the diversity that he's bringing in this, I would say that it's probably something to hold up second to none.
But given that some of his comments about Latinos, about immigration, such a hot button topic during the campaign,
right,
why not make that a priority in terms of
it is a priority. No, because I get
that signal.
Right. And I think it is a priority. But I think that it's a very narrow way to look at it and say, if you don't appoint people to this particular position, that's a problem. I just mentioned, you know, the level of diversity that's throughout not just the cabinet, but his staff and the other appointments that he's going to make. I guarantee you that as we continue to announce this, that problem will be something that people look at and respect the level of diversity throughout his entire administration. Yes, sir.
Paolo Mastroidi with the Italian daily La Stampa. Italy, as you know, will welcome President Trump to the first G7 in May. Do you think that as president of the G7, Italy should consider re-inviting Russia to the meeting?
Well, that's up to them to decide. I'm not going to get ahead of what the Italian government. Steve Holland.
How many nominees do you expect to have in the next few days confirmed? And what conversations are you having with Senator Schumer, Senator McConnell to get the process moving?
I think the vice president's been in contact with Senate leadership. I know Senator McConnell's been working tirelessly to get the situation going. There is really no excuse for the delay tactics and, frankly, the partisanship that's being exhibited by the Democrats. There's a time and a place for it, I get it. But again, I think if you hold them to the standard that they were held in 08, you recognize the fact that they are continuing to employ delay tactics after delay tactic, which isn't good for the government. I mean, I cited yesterday a poll in which over 50% of the American people believe that the national economic and security teams should be confirmed immediately. And the idea that they're delaying that further calls into question their desire to have a government of continuity. And it sends not just a signal to the folks in the United States, but frankly around the world, that they're questioning the ability of continuity of government. We've taken the proper steps to ensure, as I mentioned earlier, critical positions were filled. We have a plan to ensure that in every department there's a key individual ready to go. But I think it's disappointing that they have chosen to do this. And again, I noted this before, but if you look at the questions that are being asked in these confirmation hearings, it's not about substance, it's not about policy, it's not about the issues in front of that department. It's about partisan hacks and partisan attacks and ethical questions. That's not that these people have had their paperwork in. Their quality and caliber and integrity is unquestionable. And I think to see some of these attacks and the focus not be on issues like schools and teachers and homeland security is a problem. There are so many issues facing this country that we need to get moving on. And the idea that Democrats would use these stall tactics, it's not in the country's best interest. Yes, ma'am.
Do you think anybody will be confirmed on Monday?
I hope so. I mean, Senator McConnell has been working tirelessly to get as many nominees confirmed as possible so that we're ready to go. And as soon as Senator Schumer and other Democrats are willing to work with him, but again, you look at the comments they made. They came out with their so-called hit list. There are individuals, as I mentioned, Secretary Chao, Dr. Ben Carson, Governor Nikki Haley, that weren't on their political hit list. They are consensus candidates. And while every one of them is unbelievably qualified to lead this country in their respective department, the idea that they're expanding this list and slowing down the continuity of government is unacceptable. They owe an explanation on those three individuals at the very least. Why are they delaying Elaine Chao? Why are they not moving on Dr. Ben Carson? Why are they not moving on Governor Nikki Haley? The other ones, there's no question their qualifications, and that I would agree that they should move all of them. But those individuals weren't even on their political hit list. Why are they holding up those three individuals in particular? Yes, ma'am.
Question on trade, global trade specifically. As you're probably aware, the Chinese president lauded the merits of free trade this week. I'd ask you two questions about trade. What is your message to Beijing about the role that America is going to play in global trade? And secondly, are you willing to work with Beijing in places where you have commonalities as well as confront them in places you don't?
Yeah, I think the president's message on trade has been fairly clear. He is going to fight for American workers and American manufacturing. And that's going to be the number one thing that guides him going forward. And so he has talked about bilateral deals, making sure, but he's going to make sure that every deal that he cuts, just like he did in business, puts American workers and American manufacturing, American services, American first. And so whether it's China or any other country, That's going to be the priority. But with respect to China alone, I mean, it's a huge marketplace for American workers and small businesses. You look at the commitment that Alibaba made the other day when they met with him, talking about increasing access to small businesses. It's important that individuals who might have a craft or a product that they have, they're working at home at, or maybe it's just a small business, have the opportunity to access those marketplaces that at one point might be too far for them to reach, but through the technology that we have available to us now. And so he's going to continue to fight, whether it's the Chinese market or other places around the globe, for market access. But again, the guiding principle is always going to be the American worker and American manufacturing.
Dale House, late from WHDH-TV, Boston. Getting back to your idea that the president wants to work with and for people who weren't with him in the election.
Right.
How long will he continue trying when the other side is boycotting the inaugural and, in your own words, not helping with nominations until he says, I'm just going to work with the people who got me there?
I don't think that's going to happen. I mean, you look at the people that he's meeting with. He's got a commitment of uniting this country, bringing people together, Republicans, Democrats, people that were for him, against him, agnostic during the campaign, but he has continued to meet with people who have ideas about how to move the country forward, how to create jobs, how to reinvigorate our manufacturing base. And if people have a good idea about how to do that, he's not really concerned with what they've said or done in the past if their commitment is about the future.
He's already brought into the fold. No,
sure, he had an entire meeting with the tech industry where he sat down with 25 tech titans. I think, you know, look at some of the individuals you met. I don't think some of the individuals, I'm not going to get into some of the past statements that they may have made, but I think if you start Googling, you'll find some folks that may have been entirely focused on supporting him or supported another candidate. And that's, again, I think it's shown through his actions in terms of who he's appointed, who he's met with. This is about moving the country forward. I think he has shown a deep concern for putting America, getting America back on track, and he is really not concerned with the past. Major Garrett.
Sean, can you reconcile the Vice President-elect's statement that you're ready on day one with your comments that there are continuity of government issues created by the stall of Senate Democrats? You can't have it both ways.
Sure you can. Absolutely. Sure. I think there's a difference. As I've noted, we've appointed over 50 people in critical positions to maintain their office until we can find a successor for this administration. So we've looked through the entire government and found areas where there's a critical need to maintain someone. In an area where a department, for example, the secretary won't be available, there's a continuity in government place to ensure that the highest level person assumes those duties as acting. So
you can see those are placeholder people until your cabinet secretaries are confirmed and they can't carry out the mandate of the president.
No, there's a difference. There's a difference between enacting an agenda and making sure that if there's an issue or a concern, continuity of government is if there's an attack or some kind of weather incident that occurs where each of our departments have to be called into action to support the American people, we're ready to go. Make no mistake, we're ready to go on day one. So there's a big difference between being ready to go and start enacting some of the things. There are limitations to what some of these individuals can do in terms of enacting the agenda, but in terms of being ready to go and being able to respond to an incident, we're ready to go at 12:01 tomorrow.
Him for the entire duration of the ICE.
We'll have to evaluate that. Right now, our focus was on continuity of government, and on a case-by-case basis, we'll work with those individuals and the departments. Yes?
Shannon Pettyfuse with Bloomberg. On trade, is the president-elect going to wait until his cabinet is all in place before beginning negotiations with Mexico and Canada on NAFTA? Or if the USTR and the Secretary of Commerce are not in place, will the president go and contact those countries' presidents and begin talks directly?
I think I'm not going to get ahead of him, but I will tell you that he is part of what he announced in the executive order list around the Thanksgiving time, included the actions on both TPP and NAFTA that would be done by executive order. So I think you'll see those happen very shortly. When and where is going to, in terms of where that cabinet piece falls in, some of it has to do, frankly, right now with Senate Democrats. But I don't think he's going to wait. He has made it very clear that some of those things are huge priorities for him.
Sean.
Yes?
Sean Carly Morris from Britain's Channel 4 News. I'm just wondering, you said yesterday that there will be a couple of visits next week.
Right.
Theresa May, Britain's been told that it's the top of the list as far as trade deals.
I was talking specifically about agencies and departments.
But there are no foreign leaders expected next week?
Nothing is expected next week in terms of foreign leader visits. We'll have an update on that at some point. Phil Rucker.
Yeah, you've talked about some of the agencies and the contingency plan, but can you just address the National Security Council? in the White House. Only a couple of people, I believe, have been appointed so far. Are there going to be more appointments before tomorrow or over the weekend, or what are you doing to make sure that's
focused? Yeah, I'm not sure that that's true. I mean, we have a great group of folks that's been in constant contact with the National Security Council and the Homeland Security Council. So you've got General Flynn and KT McFarland on the national security front, Tom Bossert on the Homeland Security front. And as I mentioned, there are several individuals within both the Homeland Security Council and the National Security Council that are being held over in critical positions, and they're working with it. The other issue is that there's a lot of individuals who are detailed and are going to be staying on board. The contact and level of support back and forth in the National Security Council alone has been tremendous. We've had reams of briefings and people that have come over and met with the incoming National Security Council. That is one area where, frankly, they have been very, very aggressive and robust with both meeting with their counterparts and ensuring that the team is ready to go day one. Katie.
Ethics experts and former White House lawyers have expressed deep concern over Donald Trump's plan to separate himself from his business. The OGE director said that handing over control to his sons is not enough. He called it wholly inadequate. Given that he hasn't released his taxes, given that 74% of Americans want him to release his taxes, will he at least give a list of who he is in debt to? And if not, why not?
I think that question has been asked and answered 100 times. He stood in front, Katie, I heard the question. So I think the president-elect has made it very clear. He has no conflicts by law. He has gone above and beyond in terms of making sure that he separates himself from his business, hands it over to his kids, and then put in place a very, very rigorous plan to ensure that no conflicts of interest occur. He has gone above and beyond what is ever required of him. He has no conflicts by law. So what he has done is extraordinary to ensure that his focus is entirely on the cab, on helping this country move forward. Francesca.
Could you give us a little bit more color and information on how the then president plans to spend his first weekend at the White House, and some more information on what he plans to do during his first week, and also clarify that those departmental meetings that were coming up, like the CIA, will also be taking place next week?
Well, as I mentioned to Cecilia, I'm not going to get into the schedule at this point in terms of what he's doing, but yeah, as I read out the schedule so far as to what he's doing, he's going to, you know, there'll be time carved out for executive order signings as he chooses. There's a lot of work that's going to occur over the weekend in terms of meeting with staff, getting prepared, and then as we get closer to Monday, we'll have an update on the schedule in terms of where he might be going or other signings that he'll be conducting. Yes, ma'am. Yeah.
I was wondering, there's a lot of rumors thrown around about the first executive orders. And can you clarify whether or not he'll issue an immigration executive order on Monday or sometime next week? I know you promised that you would give us more details. I know you've already gone over the ones that deal with logistics and government operations,
right,
but there's a lot of concern about what he'll come up with in terms of immigration.
Well, look, as I said earlier, we're going to have an update on the schedule. The president-elect is still working with the team to decide how he wants to sequence these things. But I would refer you back to the video again. I mean, he laid out very clearly what his top priorities are going to be, and I think it should be no surprise to anybody that immigration, job creation, manufacturing, tax reform are all at the top of that list. And so it's just frankly a question of sequencing. But right now, he is committed to getting those things done, and we're working on the timing. Zeke Miller.
Thanks, Sean. In terms of keeping Brett McGurk and Bob Morgan, in terms of the campaign against ISIL or ISIS, the ongoing strikes, the U.S. troops who were on the ground in training or other capacities, Will all of those continue? Is the president-elect preparing to provide any new orders on that front at 12:01 tomorrow to change the current ISIS strategy?
Right. With respect to ISIS, I mean, I think he's talked about very clearly that he wants a plan from the Joint Chiefs very quickly to combat ISIS. How we look at a whole of government approach to that. He's continuing to meet with his national security team about what's in place and what he needs to do, but I'm not going to get in front of what decisions he'll make tomorrow. We'll announce all of that, but again, I think what we've ensured is that for the time being, we've got a team in place that will continue to advise him and make sure that the country remains safe and that our priorities are carried out. Shane.
Yes, right.
Shane.
Sean, last week, Trump's lawyer talked a lot about separating from his business interests. Both last night and today, he's scheduled to visit his own hotel, promote the dining room there, the food there. How do you square those two things?
That he's going to his own hotel? I mean, I think that's pretty smart. I think the idea that he's going to his own hotel shouldn't be a shocker. It's a beautiful place. It's somewhere that he's very proud of. And I think it's symbolic of the kind of government that he's going to run on time, under budget, ahead of time and under budget. Same kind of theme that the vice president-elect expressed earlier, this transition, 20% under budget, $1.2 million returned to the Treasury. He's very proud. It's an absolutely stunning hotel. I encourage you to go there if you haven't been by. But I don't think the idea that President-elect Trump is having a reception at the Trump Hotel should be a shocker to anybody. Yeah.
Trey Yingst with One America News. Now that the cabinet nominations are filled, what message do you have for senators on Capitol Hill when it comes to the speed of the confirmations?
Well, look, I think I've talked about this before, but it's important that we get these individuals up in front. There's no one that's really questioning their qualifications or their caliber or their ability to lead their department, their understanding and grasp of the issues. These are amazing individuals that have a commitment to enacting an agenda of change. And so my message is simply, let's get it done. This is not time for partisan politics. This is time to get the American, to ensure that the American people have a government in place that can get that done. Yeah, in the back.
I'm coming from Israel. Regarding the Middle East, there are plenty of reports that the president might move the American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem.
Right.
Can you confirm that he decided to do it?
What I can tell you is stay tuned. There'll be a further announcement on that. I think the president's made very clear that Israel is not gotten the attention it deserves or the respect in the last 8 years. He intends to really show his respect for Israel, the importance of it in the Middle East. And I think he has continued to talk with his team, both Ambassador-designate David Friedman, Jared Kushner, others, Rex Tillerson, about how we're going to work with Israel. I think first and foremost, how to make sure that we continue to support our ally Israel. That is something that's going to be the priority of this administration. Yes, ma'am.
You said the president was focused in finding the best and the brightest people for his government. But I wonder, can you understand that with 56 million of Hispanic people in the U.S., it's like adding offense to the injury to say that there was nobody bright enough for the president?
That's not what I said. No, I he has tremendous respect. And again, I think you have to look at the totality of diversity that exists within this cabinet. There are so many ways to express this, both in terms of gender and background, race, ideology. He continues to put together an amazingly diverse cabinet. And I think, so if you're looking specifically at Hispanics, I think as we move forward, we've got 5,000 jobs to fill. There's going to be a tremendous number of Hispanic Americans that fill those posts. And I caution people to stay tuned. Lots of great things are coming. Julie Pace.
Hey, Sean, are you guys going to send anybody to the Syria talks on Monday?
I'll have an update for you soon. I'll try to read that out to the pool. But
the thing on the numbers that you were talking about earlier, because I just want to make sure we're not conflating different things.
Right.
So you talked about the 536 people on the beachhead team.
That's right.
What does that mean in terms of the 4,000 political?
That's a great question. Thank you for clarifying that. So there's 536 individuals that are on these beachhead teams. They are temporary employees that serve as assistants to the secretary designate's office. Those individuals are able to work in the various departments as temporary officials for, I think it's up to 120 days. In some cases, they stay on. It will be up to the secretary or the administrator of the department or agency to decide whether to maintain them on. Maybe they choose to not stay on board, but in any case, that will be a decision that gets made. So if they stay, then they are counted as part of that overall thing. But again, that's a mutual decision that the incoming secretary or administrator or director would make in consultation with the individual, whether or not that they wanted to stay on board and whether the individual wanted to stay on board.
What does that mean then in terms of where you guys are on the 4,000 number?
Well, so those people are temporary. So in some cases, until the secretary or administrator or director is confirmed, they are unable to make a permanent appointment. We are working, as I've mentioned before, very, very aggressively at the undersecretary, the deputy secretary, undersecretary, assistant secretary, and ambassador levels to have individuals ready to go. Now that the cabinet is filled, I think that you will see a lot more activity at that level. But the president-elect wanted to make sure that his entire cabinet was locked and loaded before he started getting to the deputy under an assistant level. Now that that is complete, as of this morning with the appointment of Sonny Perdue as the next Secretary of Agriculture, I think you'll see a lot more activity at that lower level. Once those individuals are then confirmed, I think they will make a decision whether or not any of those 536 individuals become part of the overall package going forward. Thank you guys very much. It's been a pleasure. I look forward to seeing you on Monday. Have a great weekend, and tomorrow's going to be a very special day. Thank you.
A lot of news there, Sean Spicer, and also the Vice President-elect Mike Pence before him. Screen right, you see Fifth Avenue near 56th Street in the Trump Tower, where the President-elect will now make his way to a military plane at LaGuardia Airport and begin the trek down here to Washington, D.C. I'm Bill Hemmer, along with Shannon Bream, live here across from the White House. So you look at LaGuardia there. A number of headlines from that briefing. Let me just tick through a few by Mike Pence and then Sean Spicer. First, the incoming Vice President. He says the budget for the inauguration is on schedule and under budget, suggesting 20% of taxpayer dollars will be paid back to the Department of Treasury. In the words of Mike Pence, he says Mr. Trump knows how to sharpen his pencil as a businessman. With Sean Spicer, a number of things, Shannon, he referred to. The attitude's infectious during this historic moment here. He says Mr. Trump continues to make edits for his speech tomorrow, but he suggested it would be more an agenda and less philosophical, mm-hmm. less thematic, I would say, mm-hmm. based on the comment he had there.
Yeah, and he said it would be very personal. And I think that this is a story unlike any other. Only Donald Trump could have had this particular story. And apparently he's going to share the personal side of that and his vision for the country as well as he outlines some broader ideas that he's got.
I want to bring in Missouri Senator Roy Blunt, too, the Republican overseeing this. All things happen there on Capitol Hill. He's the chairman of the Joint Congressional Committee on Inaugural Ceremonies. And Senator, thank you for your time, for being with us today. And just give us a sense. We just heard from Sean Spicer and Mike Pence. How do you believe tomorrow will play out based on your position there on the Hill?
Well, you know, I'm looking forward to tomorrow. Certainly, it's the one major event we do every 4 years, and we do it better than anybody else to express what democracy is all about. I think what happens tomorrow in many ways is more important than exactly what's said. What's said, a lot of what's said, Shannon and Bill, is what's not said. I mean, you have every 4 years since 1789, we've inaugurated a president. As often as not since World War II, it's not just a new president, it's a different political party. And that peaceful transition of power really matters. I'm looking forward to what the president-elect will have to say a few minutes after he becomes president. But the people on that platform, people watching all over the world, the moment itself is actually more important than any specific policy that's mentioned. That transition of power matters. We're going to see that tomorrow. That's why Mrs. Clinton and President Clinton are there. That's why President Obama and Mrs. Obama will greet the Trumps at the White House early in the morning and then come to the Capitol with them.
Senator, I saw your piece in The Hill earlier today, and you pulled a statement from Ronald Reagan in 1981. He said the following: in the eyes of many in the world, this every four-year ceremony we accept as normal is nothing less than a miracle. That's a quote. And there's a reason why that's
in there. He saw it commonplace. Reagan said it was commonplace and a miracle at the same time. And we've been doing this for a long time. You know, Washington believed, Bill, that the inauguration of the second president would be a lot more important than the inauguration of the first president, because in a democracy, one person would be giving up power and giving it to another person. And then the third president, Thomas Jefferson, had what at the time was thought to be a dramatically different view of what the government could and should do than President Adams had. That may have even been a more important transition, but that pattern set in those three transitions is a pattern that we still see today. And whether it was the middle of the Civil War or the middle of World War II, in the United States of America, we had the election, the person that prevailed became the next president.
In the Hall of Politicians tomorrow, you welcome an American businessman. How different will that be?
Well, I think different, and I think different in a good way. I think the synergy that President-elect Trump and tomorrow President Trump brings to this process is a disruptive thing in a helpful way. If you want to change the way things are being done, having somebody who's not totally entrenched in the way things are being done has got to be a helpful part of getting that change made. I think the fact that he's going to be president makes everybody in our system think differently. It makes the American people look at what they would hope can happen from government differently. And I think first and foremost, he's going to be much more focused on better jobs and stronger families next year rather than being needlessly focused on things that are going to happen 25 years from now. 25 years from now matters, but it's going to be a better 25 years from now if people have better jobs next year and more opportunities next year, and the government is understands what the government's supposed to do at all levels, not just in Washington, D.C.
Senator, you've got a big job tomorrow. Best of luck to you, okay? And thank
Looking
you for your time
to
today.
It. Good to be with you.
Thank you for your time, sir. Roy Blunt, the Republican from Missouri, who just survived a very close election in his home state of Missouri, now comes back to Washington to look out on the massive crowd tomorrow before the National Mall and make the introductions.
Yeah, a big comeback there in his race. And now, as you said, he'll be here for a very important day. All right, let's bring in our panel now. Charlie Hurd is a columnist for the Washington Times and a Fox News contributor. A.B. Stoddard is an associate editor at Real Clear Politics. Great to see you both.
Good to see you, Shannon.
Good to see you, Shannon.
All right, so one of the discussions we've continued to have leading into this presidency is the use of executive action. President Obama made it clear that he would use his pen and his phone, but it also means that a lot of his legacy can be undone in the same way. AB, questions today about which executive orders he may take first, and there's a broad swath he could go for.
Right. There are so many that he can do easily that I think he's going to try to rack up the greatest number. Not all of those will be effective. Many of them are guidelines and agency directives that were not that the agencies were not bound to follow. And so, something like an emissions regulation directive that President Obama issued recently would simply be ignored. It doesn't mean that the regulations on emissions would have changed. So he can tell us about a lot of them next week that sound really great that actually mean little. Then there are hugely consequential ones like ending the Cuba deal, ending the Iran deal, not enforcing the Obamacare mandate. All of those things are hard to do, and ending the deferred action on childhood arrivals, what's known as DACA, if that would be ended, he would be deporting those children. So there's a lot of things he's promised that are quite consequential and substantive. We'll be waiting to see if he does those, but expect a long list of things that sound really great. Some of the regulations that are really meaningful, however, with regards to the environment and energy production, really have to be passed through the Congress and will take several weeks to attempt.
Well, and Charlie, there's a whole list that a number of religious and social conservatives say that they expect to get from this president, who we're now watching live as he'll soon depart New York and head to D.C. One of them comes to mind, the Department of Education guidance document that came out last year that essentially told schools all over the country, you have to agree to the transgender policy as we view it, or you risk losing federal funding. Are those the kinds of things you think that Trump will focus on in his early days?
I do, and I think that those they will actually be a big deal to the people that care most about them. And so in that regard, I think that it could help him. But look, it's been probably since 1980 that we've had an incoming administration coming in that is so diametrically opposite of the previous administration. Donald Trump ran his entire campaign on the promise that he was going to tear up these things and he was going to do all these executive actions and roll back all of the President Obama's executive actions. So it's a perfectly legitimate thing for him to be doing. But I think one of the things that, I think President Obama very much put all of his eggs in the basket of Hillary Clinton winning the White House so that she would keep all of these things. A lot of them are constitutionally spurious. I mean, the changes that he made unilaterally to Obamacare, which I think were probably unconstitutional. All of these things, it's going to be very easy for Donald Trump to roll them back.
Yeah, and you mentioned the changes to the ACA, Affordable Care Act, Obamacare. I mean, there were times that it was done via a White House blog post. I mean, that's not exactly going through the administrative procedure that normally. Yeah, that's not in the Federalist Papers. But AB, it sounds like it'll go beyond just these executive orders. Apparently, the Trump transition team putting folks on notice that they're going to make sharp cuts at Justice Department, State Department, Transportation Department, things like the National Endowment for the Arts. I mean, apparently going to go away altogether. I mean, it sounds like, just as we heard from Sean Spicer and the vice president-elect, this is going to be a president who's not afraid to cut where he sees, and in his opinion, cuts need to be made.
Right, and he'll have a Congress ready to work with him, and you know, the unified Republican government is going to be changing a lot of policies that have been in place under President Obama for 8 years. But as I said,